Mina, ohayo gozaimasu, JesusFreakinGamer here. Yeah, ohayo gozaimasu. Check out the window back there, and you'll see my finger's not quite pointing at the light that you see there. Yeah, it's not the afternoon. It's morning. It is a beautiful Monday morning here where I live. Well, from what I've seen outside, it's bright and sunny anyway. Haven't seen any rain, so I'm assuming it's beautiful. Anyway, again, didn't really sleep last night. Up this morning, and now is the time for the message. So, all that said, this is, every now and then, this is pretty much normal for me. So this is, I was like, the Sunday message is going to come out. It's going to be a full 30 minutes. Well, it's going to be not my normal, like, you know, quick 3 to 5 to 10 minutes. My short messages aren't even that short. 30 messages are, it's so weird. I like, struggle with making 30 minute messages because I'm trying to find content, and then usually I have way more than I can actually cover in 30 minutes because I tend to blather on, like I've been doing here, for several minutes. So this is for Sunday. I'm just very late, like I sometimes am. So hopefully you will forgive me for that. And even if you won't, there's not much I can do about it. I'm going to put it out as soon as I finish making it. And the video game video is also ready. That will be published at the same time as this. So without further ado, let's hop into it. This is going to be message on heaven number 2. First time we talked, oh yes, first time I talked, you listened. It was mainly on the resurrection and how the resurrection itself works. Now, one more preamble. I talked about how I've been very long in very long in the day, and it's coming out extremely late, and I also talked about what I talked about last time. I just briefly mentioned the resurrection. The preamble to why two messages when I'm not talking about heaven, I'm talking about the resurrection, and then I'm talking about, well, I haven't even told you what I'm talking about today. It's going to be judgment. It's a bit of a scary word when you think about it. And we're going to go into that and what exactly that means from a biblical Christian perspective. Why am I covering resurrection and judgment in a series on heaven? I guess I could wrap this up in title it in a different way and say, what happens to Christians or believers when they die? I guess I could wrap it up in that sense, because these things are going to be happening before we go to heaven. Now, it could be the time frame of the resurrection and the judgment could be argued. I'm not sure, and I honestly at this point forget, because it was 2 weeks ago, how much I spoke of the timing of the resurrection. I'm pretty sure I mentioned that the timing is never really nailed down. Like, you know, is it going to be as soon as we die? Is it going to be, I guess in the case of a resurrection, I don't believe I mentioned soul sleep. I'll mention it briefly here. Soul sleep is the principle. Some believers believe in it. It's not mainstream. I personally don't subscribe to it either. Soul sleep is essentially, when you die, you know, your spirit and your soul are real. They exist, and you will be in heaven with God forever. But those things won't happen until the judgment day at the end of time, when the world is done and the resurrection of the just and the unjust occurs. That I covered in detail last week. At that point, you will wake up as if from sleep, and you will have your flesh body, and you will stand before God at judgment. So you are eternal. And you will have indeed a flesh body at the resurrection, but you're not going to be in heaven until then. You're not going to be in heaven until that resurrection happens. So that'll happen at the point of the end of the world. And so that's the timing on that. So you're raised from the dead, then you're judged, then you go to heaven for those who believe in Jesus Christ. And honestly, you know, some people may think the timing of this is incredibly important. The Bible doesn't speak too highly on it, and after thinking about it, I'm not entirely convinced it's overly important. I don't believe in soul sleep. I believe, if I was to list a timing, let me go ahead and list that now. I believe that as soon as we die, we're immediately judged, and then based on that judgment, we will go to heaven or hell, and then for eternity, you know, if time passes on earth, however the mingling flow of time between eternity and here works, but we're in heaven until the resurrection, then at that point, those who are dead, we come down. It's kind of like those who are alive and remain will be caught up with the Lord in the air. I was like, actually, I don't think I covered that 1 Thessalonians reference from last time. Homework, Google, it's your friend, look it up. It's a very, very popular verse in regards to the resurrection. It's very detailed in what happens at the resurrection. It's a few more details than even 1 Corinthians 15 lists. And anyone who believes in premillennial, or I should say dispensational, premillennialism, those are big terms, and they're all wrapped up under a term called eschatology. That's another very big term that I won't be covering here, because that really is a separate subject from the eternal states, what happens to men when they die. Drink of water real quick. So look it up. It's in 1 Thessalonians, I want to say chapter 4 and 5. I believe the bulk of it's in chapter 4. And that talks about how Jesus will come down, and those who are alive will be caught up in the air, and that those who are dead will come back with him, and that the dead will be raised at that point. And so, according to your eschatology, that could also change when you think the timing of all these events is going to happen. But again, back to my belief that we'll be in hell. You know, we're gonna die. We're gonna be judged. Then, whenever the earth is over, we will be raised from the dead. And then at that point, we will go into the eternal state. From heaven, we'll go to the new heavens and new earth. Those who are in hell will go into the lake of fire, as detailed in Revelation chapter 21 and 22, both for the lost and for the saved. Now, as far as the timing goes, as far as importance, I really don't think it's overly important how you slice and dice your eschatology. Let me just go into that briefly while I'm at it. A lot of this does have to do, this ties in very closely with what you believe about the end times. Personally, I've looked at all of the views, premillennial, both classical and dispensational, postmillennial, and amillennial. Ultimately, when I look at the Bible, I don't think the Bible really supports any of the three views definitively, or I guess four views if you break off premillennialism into its two different camps. I don't really think the Bible supports any of the four camps definitively. I think there's room for a little bit of like differentiation in all four. The Bible seems to indicate things in all four camps, and then the Bible seems to contradict points of all four camps. And actually, shame on me, there is a fifth camp, preterism, that believes that all of the, that literally everything, the whole resurrection and the new heavens and the new earth and the raising from the dead, the judgment, that all of these things have happened in the past, specifically 70 AD. Some will argue to what degree that these things have happened. There are partial and full preterists. I'm not trying to make an L for loser. I'm not saying that those people are just so much more wrong than the other people. They actually have some pretty valid arguments, and it's really interesting. They're kind of poo-pooed upon and frowned upon by the mainstream church. I don't really see their arguments as that much inferior to all the other eschatological arguments. In fact, if I had to say there was one camp out of, that would be what, six? I guess I'm going in. This is still not heaven. This is a summary. And it ties into heaven and end times and the eternal states. So I feel like it's just for me to cover it at least briefly. We have dispensational premillennialists, classical premillennialists, postmillennialists, amillennialists, partial preterists, and full preterists. And there are variations between all six of those camps, and there are five camps in general. If you get rid of the two types of preterism and the two types of premillennialism, then there are just five camps altogether. Or actually, no, I'm sorry, there'd be four camps altogether. Math, how does it work? Premillennialism, postmillennialism, amillennialism, and preterism. And then there are the two camps of preterism and premillennialism. All of these are, I know they're huge words, and you're like, what the heck are you talking about? This makes no sense. How do I even spell that to Google search it? I will try to remember to link, to at least spell those words out for you in the description. I will try to remember to do that so you can do research on these matters. If anyone falls into a camp where I disagree with, the strongest it would be the dispensational premillennialists. I feel like that camp who interprets all the events of Revelation literally has the weakest arguments. Won't go into why or how or what. Maybe in a future message. Possibly. Not a huge eschatology guy. If I had to think of anyone who had the strongest biblical arguments, if there is there one group that has just a really strong set of arguments, it would be, for me, that's hard. I really do see a blend of classical premillennialism, amillennialism, and postmillennialism. I really see a blend of those three pretty strongly in Scripture. There's a lot of all three going on. There's a lot of, I can't commit to any one of them fully because there are several points where that those views just don't cover everything. There are things that just simply get wrong, and even historically some things have been proven wrong. But then there are some biblical points overall where I can see all three shine in various ways. It's hard for me to say which of, I would say it's a blend. If there was a way to blend those three into one eschatological view, that would be my view on the end times. And with all of that said, as far as the timing of all these events, I told you the order in which I think it will happen. And so, and since I don't believe in any rapture of any kind, that's why I just said, you know, there will be a resurrection. I didn't include a rapture because I don't believe in it. There will simply be the resurrection. The rapture is a part of that when those who are alive and remain are caught up in the clouds to be with the Lord. At the time of the resurrection, all of the saints, the living and the dead all at once at that time, and then we go into the eternal states. That's my personal view on end times and the timing of these events. Does it ultimately matter? Not really. It really doesn't. If I am asleep and I wake up into a new flesh body and then my judgment occurs, I'll be like, well, doggone it, my timing was wrong. Crap. And that's about the extent of my, that'll be the about the extent of it. Then I'll go on to be judged by the Lord, and I will go into heaven. If what I say is correct, I'll be judged, get that part out of the way, spend time in heaven, and then eventually I'll get a flesh body and then go into the new Jerusalem, the new heavens, and the new earth. It's not ultimately going to affect me greatly. And since the Bible doesn't spend a whole lot of time trying to discuss the timing of these events and how they correlate with each other, it simply says these things are going to happen at some point. And all these things happen when we die. Unless Jesus comes in our lifetime, then of course the resurrection will be here and now. And if dispensational premillennialism is right, and the rapture happens, and I skip out on 7 years of tribulation, and then I'm in heaven in a glorified flesh body, and then there's the judgment, and then there's 1,000 years before the eternal state, if it happens that way, I'm not too fussed about it. Oh, darn, I missed 7 years of horrible tribulation on the earth. Doggone it all. I'm not going to complain about that. I'm really not. But biblically, I do know that there's going to be a resurrection, a judgment, and an eternal state. Those things I know for absolute certainty. There may be some ambiguity on the timeliness of these things and how they all correlate, but what we do know definitely is that these things are going to occur. So the things that are definite, those are the things that I plan on covering here. And this is, and I don't think I said it earlier. If I did, I'll say it again. This particular message will be on judgment. Now that I've gotten all of the timing of these things out of the way, that was kind of its own subject. This will be a three-part message. Heaven itself, I'm going to save for part three. I'm actually going to look into heaven and what that entails at a later point. Maybe I'll save a little bit of judgment for next time, possibly. We'll see. We'll see how it goes. But there will definitely be a part three to this series at this point. And again, this is the end of my day, so I didn't explain the first two yawns. It's the end of my day. Any of you who follow me on a regular basis, and I know there aren't many, God bless you and thank you, those of you who do. For me, it's simply the end of the day, so I'm a little bit tired. You know, I've done whatever I've done all day, be it video games or just chilling or hanging out with friends, whatever it is. I've done that all day. This is the end of the day, so I'm a little on the tired side. But moving along, judgment. This could potentially be one of the most important messages that I've ever preached. The first time I said that, it was in regards to the love of God. God loves you. He wants you to be saved. He wants you in heaven. Two was the message on the Bible, what I think about the Bible and why it's the infallible Word of God, or actually not exactly the infallible Word of God, but for the most part it is, and what the heck I mean by that. I made a message on that. It's about an hour long, but I wanted to cover everything in one message. I didn't want to skimp on anything there, so I just was like, I think it's like 58 minutes and some change. So I was like, 58 minutes? Who cares? I've got to do this in one go. I've got to keep going. I've got to make this in one message. But judgment, even though I'm down to like 15-ish minutes on this message, judgment is so important. It's so important, guys. And I'm going to cover the biblical message, like why Christians believe what they believe. But when we think of judgment, at least in America, we have a general idea of what that means. We stand before God. He knows everything. He judges every action, word, and thought. And then the decision is made. He's your judge. You go to heaven or hell. That's the general understanding of judgment in America. And the biggest flaw is what constitutes going to heaven and going to hell. And as I've talked about in every single one of my 30-minute messages, what you need to do to go to heaven, and I will cover it at the end of this message as well, and most certainly at the end of the heaven message itself, I almost feel like judgment is more important than talking about heaven itself, because here's the thing. Heaven's great. Heaven's wonderful. Hell is terrible. Hell is nasty. What determines where you go is judgment. That's what sends you to one place or the other. I can talk about the horrors of hell all day. I can talk about the wonders of heaven all day. But ultimately, your judgment is what's going to determine where you go. That's the deciding line. That's the deciding point. And if we don't understand how judgment works, if we don't understand what's being judged, what God's looking for, what he thinks of as good, what he thinks of as merits heaven, and what he thinks of as merits hell, because he's the judge, not us. And I know not everyone believes in God and the judgment as Christianity does. I fully understand that. And in the future, I'll talk about, you know, false religions, wrong beliefs. I'll discuss those things. I'm a very exclusivistic Christian. Christianity is right. Jesus is right. Period. I've made no bones about that from the beginning. And I look forward to future messages where I get to talk about these things in more detail. But for the time being, I don't think I can put into words, I don't think I can stress enough how important it is that we make sure that we get our judgment right. That when we stand before God, we know where we're going, heaven or hell, or is there a purgatory? Is there somewhere in between? I don't think I can emphasize, even, you know, beyond the places, we can debate which places are there and which aren't, even in Christianity. A lot of you guys have heard of purgatory. That is a Catholic belief, not a Protestant belief. And I am more of I come from a Protestant background, and I don't see any biblical evidence for purgatory. I was actually saved Baptist, and I strongly disagree with their dispensational premillennialism. I don't agree with that at all. I've studied the Bible for myself. I have my own set of beliefs, and I don't see purgatory. But regardless of position, regardless of placement, regardless of your denomination, hopefully you'll hear me out. If we're going to be judged by God, knowing about that judgment and knowing where our judgment's going to land us, you know, knowing the places is to a degree important, but knowing the criteria, especially to get into heaven and to avoid hell, the in-betweens aren't nearly as good or nearly as bad as those two. So whatever degree in between, I need to know how to get to the best place. I need to know how to avoid the worst place, and if possible, all the places in between. And if the Bible tells us about that, then we need to, oh my gosh, we need to know that. There is nothing more important than understanding judgment. Having said all that, let's go into some points. First, the biblical fact that there is a judgment. Most Christians don't even question this fact, and to any believers out there, those will be preaching to the choir, but maybe you don't even know why. Why do Christians believe that? Why do you accept it? Is it even in the Bible? Let's look it up. Did I mention judgment? I think I mentioned judgment briefly in the last message. I didn't mention the wheres or the hows. I might have mentioned one verse, possibly. I didn't look over that message before I preached this one. Hebrews 9:27. Let's go there first. And again, I'm of the old school. I love to actually look it up in a Bible. Google is fine, and I've certainly used Google before, but if possible, I like to have my Bible open. I like to turn to the message. I just, in that sense, I'm old-fashioned, and I make no apology for it. Hebrews 9, verse 27. And as it is appointed for men to die once, and but after this, the judgment. And we can just stop there. You want the context of verse 28? I'll read it. Let me read it just as it one statement real quick. And as it is appointed for man to die once, but after this the judgment, so Christ was offered once to bear the sins of many. To those who eagerly wait for him, he will appear a second time, apart from sin, for salvation. And that talks about the resurrection there. Again, judgment and resurrection are very closely tied in together, and all these have to deal with after man's death and the eternal state. That's why I'm covering all this in my series on heaven. But yeah, it's appointed for men to die once, but after this, the judgment. Boom. You want to know timing? Regardless of how some of this stuff works, and I could even point to this verse as far as saying, I think the judgment happens before we go to heaven. You die once, then the judgment, and to those who eagerly wait for him, he will appear a second time. Then there's the resurrection. I think judgment happens first, after we die. And some of my time belief is based on this verse. That's where I get it from. As soon as it's like once man dies, then there's the judgment. To me, that's the timing. After we, and also it makes sense to me, like, how are we going to know where to go and why we're going there if judgment doesn't happen first? For those going to heaven and to those going to hell, if there isn't a judgment to explain to those people why they're going where they're going, I guess those who know they're going to heaven because they know Jesus, yeah, they know where they're going. And I won't assume that every Christian knows all the details about judgment or heaven. That's one of the reasons why I like to cover these things via the Bible, via Scripture, because I want Christians not to just know what they believe. I want them to know why they believe it. Sometimes I think the why is a little bit more than the what. If you believe something and have no reason for it, that's pointless. In fact, that's a bit stupid. Let me just be very bluntly honest here, like I always am. I'm going to give you the truth even when it hurts. It's a bit stupid to believe in something and not know why. If you're going to believe in something, have a reason why. Even though I didn't know everything, that's one of the reasons why before I got saved, I had a discussion with a deacon for about, I discussed things like after dinner until midnight. Hours of discussion. Because I wanted to thoroughly understand, and by thoroughly, it was very surface-level stuff. I mean, I was just looking into Christianity at that time, and I'd been to church for a few weeks, but I wanted to understand, you know, what am I getting into if I join Christianity? What am I getting into if I believe in this Jesus? I certainly didn't have all the verses that I have now, and I didn't understand it all, but I wanted to have a bare-bones, let me get this straight, here's what the Bible says about Jesus. Here's what the Bible says about being saved. Here's what the Bible says about going to heaven. And I had him show me verses in the Bible, like, show me why you believe this stuff. And it's just, it's not good to believe these things for no reason. Faith is good, but have a reason for it. Have a reason why you believe what you believe. There does come a point where you have faith for God's sake. You have faith in things that are completely unseen and that you don't really have a reason. But that reason ends up being other things. Like, you don't have faith. I believe in that. Just a very broad example. I believe in this with no evidence. But the reason I have this faith with no evidence is because there are other things I believe that have evidence. Therefore, I can take my faith to the next level and believe in some things that are completely unseen. I believe in Jesus Christ because there's good evidence that the Bible isn't just a pack of lies and an altered form from thousands of years and from thousands of years ago, and that there's actually good reason to believe that Jesus might actually have risen from the dead past all naturalistic reasoning and logic. There are some actually fairly solid reasons to believe in these things. That's why not only did I become a Christian, I looked into it at the time, but once I did a little bit more thorough research and I tried to dig under the surface, I stayed a Christian. And I'm not saying I never will lose my faith, but I never have, even when I walked in sin, I never completely lost my faith. I just thought that my judgment would be hell itself because I wasn't living for God. But I never lost my faith in Jesus Christ because when I looked into it, I couldn't really disprove it. It was too convincing. It was too thorough. And I didn't cover much of anything. Time is almost up for this message. Holy smoke. There was more to cover than judgment. This may be a four-part message. Well, maybe I'll wrap up judgment and heaven all into one message. We'll see what happens. I have as many messages as I have Sundays, and as long as YouTube exists. And if YouTube doesn't exist, I'm sure there will be some other... There are going to be video sites. Those aren't going to go away now that YouTube's popularized. I'm so glad I've been able to be on YouTube and be a part of that while it's here. Just to wrap up the fact that we will be judged, I want to proceed to Acts 17:31. Let me read that verse to you. Acts 17:31, because he has appointed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by the man whom he has ordained. He has given assurance of this to all by raising him from the dead. So God will judge the world in righteousness by Jesus Christ. That is what that verse has in store right there. And I'll say there's another verse that talks about the fact that we'll be judged, but it also talks about what will be judged. So I'll save that for next time. But that's two verses right there that talk about judgment. You know, that man will be judged at some point. And there are so, you can by all means look behind me. Those are two verses, and that's enough to make us think, well, hey, resurrection and judgment. Resurrection of the just and the unjust, some kind of judgment was hinted at there. Two verses explicitly saying there's going to be a judgment after this life. The Bible is very clear, and there are several verses after this. Feel free to Google behind me. There are several verses that explicitly state that we will be judged. And to go ahead and fast forward to what we need to know without going into a ton of details, I will go into those details next week. The biggest and most important thing, the thing that will determine heaven or hell. And biblically, there really is no evidence for anything else. It's just one or the other. It's very binary. It's heaven or hell. The thing that will get you into heaven is, do you believe in Jesus Christ? Is he your Lord and Savior? That's the biggest thing that will be judged on. John 14:6, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes unto the Father but by me. So that is the biggest judgment point. Have you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior? Have you asked him to forgive you of your sin? It really is that simple. All you got to do is ask. Believe that Jesus died on the cross for you. Believe that Jesus rose from the dead. Ask him to be your God, your Lord, your Savior, your Master, for forgiveness for your sins, and he'll forgive you. It is as simple as believing in him and asking him to forgive you and believing that he's forgiven you. It's as simple as that. I will go into more details next week on how that is, why that is, but that really is it, in a nutshell. Believe in Jesus, and you're saved. You'll start a relationship with God. God wants you in heaven. He wants to be with you, and Jesus paved the way, dying a horrible, torturous death on the cross, shedding his blood for the remission. That's a kind of a fancy legal term, to forgive you for your sin. So if you want to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, do so right now. I'm not going to stop you. I'm going to encourage it. And hopefully no one around you is encouraging you otherwise. And if they are, I would strongly recommend blotting them out from vision and from hearing, maybe even from memory temporarily, and accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. If you know in your heart you need to do so, don't hesitate. Don't wait till tomorrow. And if you're convinced at this moment, if you don't need any further evidence, then don't wait. If you have genuine doubts and genuine curiosities, like, I'm really not convinced, I would actually encourage you, don't hesitate. You know, please do hesitate. Don't jump into something you're not sure of. Like, I had to look into this. I went to church for a few weeks. I pestered the deacon that I talked to a lot for hours about things that I needed to understand. But for those who are really feeling in their hearts, man, I need to do this. I've been putting this off for far too long. I know I'm a sinner. I know I need God's forgiveness. For those of you who are sure, for those of you who are just putting it off for some reason, stop. Just stop right now. This needs to stop. You need to accept Jesus right now. You need to become a Christian right now. Do it! Just do it! Don't put this off until tomorrow. If you don't need any more evidence, why are you waiting? Accept Jesus right now. And if you want a model prayer, if you don't know exactly what to say, then let me give you something to follow. Follow me. Again, don't wait. Follow me in this prayer right now. Right now. No, don't plug away. Don't say you'll think about it some more. If you know you need Jesus, if you genuinely don't need other evidence, and you know in your heart you need Jesus, pray this prayer after me right now. Say, Lord Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. I'm not going to try to hide it. I'm not going to try to put this off any longer. I know I'm a sinner. I know you're real. And I know I need you. And after hearing what Brandon's had to say, and after thinking about this and looking into this myself, I know that you died on the cross for me. I even believe that you rose again from the dead. Would you please right now be my God, be my Lord, be my Savior, be my Master. Forgive me for all my sins. And please accept me into your kingdom of heaven. I need you right now, God. And thank you so much for hearing and answering this prayer right now as I've prayed it. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. If you prayed that prayer and you meant it, then you want to know something. You made the right choice. You made the right call. You are heaven bound. You don't have to worry about hell or negative consequences after this life any longer. Jesus has saved you. He's forgiven you. And he is not done with you yet. He's going to march you forward into a new life with him right now. And if you are somewhere close to death, please rest assured, even if your entire life was wasted, and even if the judgment you face is a wasted life, you still know God now. You're still going to heaven now. So please die in peace. Please die in comfort and in rest. Please don't worry about what's going to happen to you after this life. You're now forgiven. You're now saved. You're now going to heaven. For those of you who are not near death, for those of you maybe a little bit on the younger side, because my channel has appealed to you, and most of the people in my generation are, and the people who love video games are of the younger crowd, you've got a life ahead of you that God's going to change you, shape you, mold you, drag you away from your sinful inclinations, and draw you closer to his side. And if I can encourage you in that direction, read this. This is the Bible, by the way. Read this a little bit every day. It'll get you knowing your God's thoughts, what's on your God's mind, what's in his heart, what he wants for you, your family, your future, for this world and the world's future. Also, attend a Bible-believing church. So people who agree that this Bible is the Word of God, that you can trust it. Find some people who are Christians who agree with you. It's great when you find a group of people that will encourage you and build you up in the faith that you now have. Don't be afraid to talk to those new people and tell them, I just accepted Christ. I'm a new Christian. Some people will be like, oh, that's great. Congrats. If that's the end of the conversation, because I have talked to some Christians who are like that. I remember talking to some Christians when I was lost, and I was like, Christianity sounds cool. I'm kind of interested. I've never talked to a lost person like that. I said that to some people who were Christians, and they were like, first, if you're a Christian and you're watching this, please don't be that Christian. And second, if you're a new Christian, or even if you're not completely convinced yet, but you've listened to this whole message, thank you so much. God bless you for that. Don't give up. Keep finding people who are interested in talking to you, who are interested enough in Jesus to explain it to you and to come up alongside you, give you the time of day. Please don't give up because a few people aren't personable and aren't willing to be close to you. Please, if nothing else, talk to me online. I don't have many subscribers right now. I can pretty, unless this message like is months old, if you talk to me, you know, after I just preached a message within a few days, I can like 100% guarantee you, short of me dying or getting deathly ill, that I'll respond to you and I'll talk to you and I'll try to answer your questions to the best of my ability. So please try to find believers. And don't settle for me, though. Try to find some people in person. that that you can talk to, that can encourage you in your faith. And I know I've gone way over, 4 minutes over, pushing 5 minutes. Lastly, shoot up a prayer, just a little bit each day. A simple, God, thank you for the day, or God, this day sucks, help, those count as prayers. Just a little bit a day will go leagues and miles in helping you advance in your Christianity. Guys, thank you for sticking with me to the bitter end. Look forward to the next part of this message. I love you, and God bless.